I would like to tell you about the new, by the way, let me say I'm so glad to see you out here this Sabbath evening. I'd like to tell you about this latest issue of the 1888 Message newsletter. Dust off the press. I brought them up with me when I came here last Tuesday. The lead article here is written by our dear brother Elder John Peters, who has spoken here and is, I hope, present tonight. It's on Hebrews chapter 9. And Elder Peters has made what I believe is a stupendous discovery that I believe in God's providence is going to revolutionize Seventh-day Adventist thinking. He has found evidence that in chapter 9 of Hebrews, the Apostle Paul was discussing the work of Christ in the most holy apartment. He uses a term which in the Greek, diorthosis, when studied carefully, is seen to be a synonym of the Hebrew term that is translated cleansed in Daniel 8:14. And he finds evidence that the Apostle Paul was telling his readers that now is not the time to discuss the ministry of our great high priest in the most holy apartment, because now he's ministering in the first apartment of the heavenly sanctuary. But there is a time appointed of deorthosis, that is, of straightening out, of cleansing, of making right. Then the ministry in the most holy apartment will be the topic of study. The work of Christ in the most holy apartment is the greatest news that this world can ever hear. Something is happening that has never happened before. And not only is this merely the foundation truth that has made the Seventh-day Adventist Church what it is, it is the foundation of our faith. This church was built upon Daniel 8:14. It is Daniel 8:14 that distinguishes this church from the Seventh-day Baptist Church. We have a special understanding of the work of Christ, our high priest, in his closing atonement on this cosmic day of atonement. And our people are just hungry to understand that. I took an afternoon off not too long ago. I told my brethren in the General Conference about it. I said I went to the Weimar College Library and I spent several hours reading through the entire file of 52 issues of the Adventist Review. And I told him, I found nothing about this particular work of the closing atonement. And I was rather surprised. The General Conference brethren agreed. Our people need to know what Jesus is doing today. They need to have their vision lifted from this egocentric, fear-motivated concern. Will I squeak by the investigative judgment? Am I going to get into heaven? And I've had dear church members call me up and, oh, Elder Wieland, you know, if I can only squeak into the pearly gate and get inside, I don't care if I have a mansion like Paul has, I'll sleep on the grass. And I say, shame on you. The supreme motivation is not saving your own poor little skin. The supreme motivation is bringing honor and glory to the Savior who went to hell and died your second death to save you. Amen. And instead of praying, oh Lord, whatever you do, be sure you save me in your kingdom. Oh yes, and save my loved ones. We should be praying, Lord, help me somehow to honor the one who died for me. Well, tonight, I would like for us to have a little simple, old-fashioned Bible study. In the book of Jeremiah, chapter 37, you'll read there, I think it's verse 15, I won't take the time to look at it, because our time is short tonight. You'll read about one of the darkest days in the history of God's people, when the Babylonian army had surrounded the city of Jerusalem and were laying siege to the city. King Zedekiah, a descendant of King David, who should have had faith in his heart, was terrified. He had put the prophet Jeremiah in the dungeon, but he was so frightened that he called the soldiers to go get him, bring him out, and bring him to his office. He wanted to ask a question: is there any word from the Lord? Now, that's the question that we are asking. Somebody right here this week, since we started, asked me a question: are we going to go on for 50 years more or 100 years more? Are we going to come back here, say, 50 years from now, this beautiful church, and have another conference like this, and on and on? It is now 159 years since the midnight cry of 1844, when on October 22, according to the prophecy, Jesus left the first apartment, closed the door to it, opened the door to the second apartment, and passed there to do his final work of ministry. And one of the most terrible things that Ellen White ever took her pen to write is in her book, Early Writings, pages 55 and 56, where she saw what had happened. She saw Jesus close the door to the first apartment and enter the second. And then she says, I watched those who followed him by faith. In other words, those who went through the great disappointment and refused to scuttle their faith. They were convinced that the Holy Spirit was in that midnight cry. They had never seen that demonstration so clearly before. They couldn't understand what went wrong, what their mistake was, but they were hanging on by faith, and they hung on until the answer came that the cleansing of the sanctuary was not the cleansing of this earth by fire, but the beginning of Christ's final work of atonement. It's been 159 years since then. In 1833, the stars fell. The last of the celestial signs, 170 years ago. And I'm so simple-minded, all I can do is take the Bible and read it and believe it like it reads. It's all I can do. And ever since I was baptized 74 years ago, I discovered the Sabbath truth in a Presbyterian Sunday school and made my decision, yes, I must keep the Sabbath. Thankful ever since. I did two good things in my life. I made a decision to be baptized into the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Amen. And I married Grace, who was sitting out there. Two good things that I did. But I had the faith to believe. I had the blessed hope, that's what the Bible calls it, of the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior that's going to be in our lifetime. And Jesus said, of those who see those celestial signs and recognize what they mean, this generation shall not pass away till all be fulfilled. And we argue up and down as to what that means, forgetting it was Jesus' intention to come within the lifetime of those people. In 1856, the Lord sent an angel to Ellen White. That is 147 years ago, when she was in a conference in Battle Creek in May of that year. And the angel said to her, of the people present at this conference, Some are going to become food for worms, a very crude expression. That's what the angel said. And some sad news are going to be like Judas Iscariot and betray sacred trusts, and they will accept the mark of the beast. And some today will do that. But there's good news, and some who are here at this conference, she said, will be alive and remain upon the earth to be translated when Jesus comes. And we've argued up and down trying to explain that. Some people say, oh, that proves Ellen White's a false prophet. No, it doesn't. She didn't say it. The angel did. And the angel was only telling what he believed was true, because he was so happy. He knew that the 2300-day prophecy had come to an end. And here was a people who had followed Christ into the most holy apartment. They were accepting every ray of light that God sent them. They accepted the Sabbath truth when it came from Rachel Preston. They didn't fight the Sabbath truth. They welcomed it to their hearts and kept the Sabbath holy. They loved the truth and accepted the health reform as best they knew it. Every ray of light that came, they accepted it. And the angel was so happy to see this. He was sure, surely, these people will get ready for the coming of the Lord in their lifetime. 32 years later, the Lord sent the beginning of the latter rain. Yes, it was God's plan to honor the faith of that angel. But strangely, for the first time, this little group of people began to fight against the Lord's leading. And that precious gift, the beginning of the latter rain, was resisted and rejected and kept away from God's people and from the world. Well, now tonight, is there any word from the Lord? Of course, what I could do, I could get Ellen White's books. She was the Lord's messenger, right? And she wrote 25 million words. You couldn't read them all in one lifetime, I don't think. Although she wrote them in one lifetime, night and day. But if I read a ream of Ellen White quotations to you tonight as being some word from the Lord, you will say, oh, Brother Wieland, you're taking those out of context. In this other place over here, Ellen White says something different, and we'd have a quarrel as to whether or not my selection from Ellen White is exactly appropriate to the needs of this congregation tonight. And so I would like to go straight to the words of Jesus. And I would like to study with you verse by verse, word by word, what he says to the Seventh-day Adventist Church today. It's in Revelation chapter 3. Hope you brought your Bible. You should always bring your Bible when you come to the house of God, because you never can know when the Holy Spirit's going to speak to you from the Word. And we start with verse 14. It's the message to the seventh of the seven angels of Revelation 2 and 3. And I don't think there's any argument among our scholars or our theologians today as to how to apply the messages of those seven churches. I think everybody is agreed that the seven angels of Revelation 2 and 3 are symbolic of God's people, God's church, in seven periods of world history, from the time of the apostles, the time of the terrible persecution, the time of the apostasy, the dark ages. There was a true church through the dark ages, and then the church of the Reformation, the church of Sardis, then the church of Philadelphia, which may include the Wesleyans, I don't know, but it did include the early Advent movement, and then last of all, Laodicea. Verse 14. First of all, to whom is the message addressed? Anybody know? I'm glad somebody answered correctly. It is not addressed to the church. And yet we pastors, and I'm one of them, have been in the habit of throwing this latest in message at our people. You are the people that are lukewarm. You are the people that need to repent and so forth. And that's not what Jesus said. It's addressed to the angel of the church of the Laodiceans. And what is the angel of the church? Well, going back to chapter 1 of Revelation in the last verse, we read there that Jesus specifies that the angels of the church, of the churches, and the churches are distinct entities. They're not the same thing. The angels are the seven stars in Christ's right hand. But the seven candlesticks are the seven churches. Quite different. In Gospel Workers, I think it's page, somewhere there, page 13, yeah. And Book of Acts of the Apostles, very clear, there's several statements where the servant of the Lord identifies these stars in the right hand of Jesus as the leaders of God's church. And of course, we'll have to admit that's primarily the general conference. Primarily. You can't get around that. Secondarily, the division conferences, and then the union conferences, and then the conference leaders. But not only they, the pastors. Every pastor is one of those stars in the hands of Jesus, the leader of the church, the one who is responsible for the spiritual life of the church. And if there are any young people here thinking about going into the ministry, I would say if you can possibly stay out of the ministry, do so unless you know God is calling you. This is the most terrible place to stand if God hasn't called you to stand here. And it includes also the local elders of the church. You know, the pastors come and go, the elders remain. And the spiritual condition of a local congregation or church is largely dependent upon the spiritual leadership of the elders. And then the Sabbath school teachers are the stars in his right hand. Yes, those who teach the kindergarten and those who teach the pathfinders. And oh, I have such a burden on my heart to help the pathfinders. Because so often their philosophy is based upon old covenant concepts. And the old covenant is not the way to teach our boys and girls. Ellen White tells us that your broken promises and forfeited pledges weakens your confidence in your own sincerity and makes you feel like God cannot accept you. And that's how our kids feel so many times. Roger Dudley wrote a book, you know, Why Teenagers Leave the Church. And he found out as he interviewed a lot of teenagers, not in high schools, not Adventist kids in high schools, but Adventist kids in our academies. And they kept telling him over and over, yeah, I'd like to go to heaven, but I don't think I can make it. I'm not good enough to get there. They've been imbued with old covenant ideas. How desperately this church worldwide needs to understand the news of the new covenant. The new covenant is just as simple and clear as 2 + 2 = 4. It is not complicated. The new covenant is God's promise. And the old covenant is a people's promise. And your salvation depends upon who you believe. Well, all right, let's hurry along here. Back to Revelation chapter 3. To the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write. These things says the Amen. That word Amen in the Hebrew is a word for believe. And even in Kiswahili in East Africa, our infinitive for to believe is kuamini. And we got it in Swahili from the Arabic, and they got it straight from the Hebrew. And here it is. He's introduced to the church of the Laodiceans, to the angel of the church, as the one who believes. We're not saved by our faith. We're saved by the faith of Jesus. But he's the faithful and true witness. If you had a bad stomach ache, you went to your doctor and he tells you a lot of jokes and makes you laugh and gives you a pill and says, you'll be all right. Take this aspirin and you'll feel better. When in reality, you got a cancer growing there, but he makes you happy. Would you like him for a doctor, or would you like to have a faithful and true witness who tells you, get to the hospital as quickly as you can in order to save your life? Jesus is a faithful and true witness. Ellen White used to pray, and some of the folks in her household heard her pray vocally, Lord, show me the worst of my case. And he says here again, I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I wish you were cold or hot. He doesn't like anybody sitting on the fence. He wants us to come down and face reality. And if we reject him, all right. Go ahead and reject him. He wants you to make your decision. But of course, he hopes you make the right decision. But I wish you were one or the other. And then verse 16 is a real problem. I love the King James Bible, and it's the one I use. Although I realize it is not a perfect translation, I don't think there's a perfect translation anywhere, to tell the truth. You have two eyes so you can see with perspective. You need more than one Bible. Yes. Get every Bible you can and study them and compare them. Get all the wisdom you can. Anyway, that 16th verse is not right in the King James. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, it says, I will spew thee out of my mouth. And that is not what Jesus said. Maybe you want to write it in the margin what he said. He said, I am about to spew you out of my mouth. It's almost like I'm standing here on the edge of this platform. I'm just about to jump off, but I decided I'm not going to jump off. And to translate this into proper California English, what Jesus said is, you make me so sick at my stomach, I feel like throwing up. That's what he said. Is there any word from the Lord? Yes, there is. We come here and we sing these lovely hymns, My Jesus, I love thee, you know, blah, blah. And the Lord knows jolly well that what we really love is the world. Don't you dare say, I love Jesus, unless really you do. And you know, when the Lord asked Peter, Peter, do you love me with agape? After his, you know, after the denial, Christ's resurrection, Peter had more sense than to say yes. He said, Lord, I wouldn't dare say I love you with agape. I love you with philos, which is family affection. Well, we must be very careful and not to make Jesus nauseous. So he says in verse 17, because you say, and here's why we make him sick at his stomach. You say I'm rich and increased with goods. I don't need anything. I got 27 wonderful, perfect doctrines. And we have all these institutions all around the world. We're baptizing people by the thousands and thousands and thousands. I heard it somewhere this week how many we baptize every hour. Does somebody remember? I forget what the figure was. And we're so proud of the marvelous achievements that we're accomplishing all around the world. I was baptized, as I said, 74 years ago. I don't remember I've ever heard any pastor or conference leader ever use these words that Jesus says, we say, that I'm rich. I saw it in one book, yes. So that's the same as saying it. But you don't know your true condition, he said. You are the emperor with his new clothes. And Hans Christian Andersen's story. Striding down the street stark naked and you don't know it. Have you ever had a dream where you were improperly clothed in public? The shame that you felt, the embarrassment. Maybe the Lord lets us have those dreams to remind us of something. Blessed is he that keepeth his garments, lest he walk naked, and they see his shame. And you have to buy the clothing. He says, I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, which is genuine faith. Not the what raises your hand, yeah, I believe in Jesus. No. We're having a problem. Everywhere. Understanding what faith really is. You ask Billy Graham, what is faith? He will tell you it's trusting Jesus. And he, it's not that he's wrong, but he doesn't understand. And I'm afraid that the average Adventist pastor will give you the same definition. But that's not the Bible definition of what faith really is. See, trust always involves an egocentric concern. I trust my money in the bank because I'm scared to keep it lying around the house. I don't want to bury it in the backyard. I trust the police, thank the Lord. I trust the government. Yes, I do. Do I trust Jesus from an egocentric concern that I can't save myself, therefore I got to trust him to save me? Genuine faith is not concerned about the salvation of your soul. Genuine faith is a heart-melting appreciation of the breadth and length and depth and height of the love, that unearthly love that led the Son of God to die your second death. And you're not thinking about whether you get to heaven or not. That does cross your mind. He died for me, I must live for him. That is faith. That is the gold tried in the fire. And I hope we can come to that in just a few moments in a little more detail. And then the white raiment. He's not going to give it to you. You got to buy it. And I've often wondered, what do you have to pay to get it? Well, I don't know, unless you've got to give him all your dirty rags. And so, for some little brief moment, you stand there before him in the sight of the entire universe of God, stark naked, without a thread to cover you. And then you can appreciate the gift of the robe of his righteousness that he gives you. And if you've got the gold and the white raiment, then you automatically have the eye salve. Now in verse 19, there's something very strange here. He says, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Now, you would think, since the New Testament talks so much about agape, the word for love repeatedly is agape. So you would expect that here Jesus would say, as many as I love with agape, I rebuke and chasten. But no, that's not the word he uses. He uses the word philos, phileo. As many as I love with philos, family affection, I rebuke them, chasten them. What does that mean? Why does he say that? Well, maybe I can help a little bit. I got a wife, thank the Lord, she's here tonight. Every pastor needs a wife like I have, who can tell you off when you get off the rails. and get you back on the rails again. I got three kids, and they don't mince words. They'll talk to me and say, Daddy, this or that, and they will bawl me out. But I never get mad, because we are bound together in a family tie that can never be broken. And so Jesus says, I am one with you in a family, a tie that can never be broken. So you won't get mad, will you, if I bawl you out, if I rebuke you and chasten you. And so he says in verse 20, and here is something that touches my heart. He says, Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And then the King James says, If any man or anyone hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. I used to wonder what that means. And once when I was at Andrews University, I was rummaging through some old books down in the basement of the library, and I found an old book there written by some godly man, scholar of, I think, 200 years ago, in which he was commenting on this, and he said those words, I stand at the door and knock, have been lifted, quoted from the Old Testament, from the Song of Solomon. Now, they taught me in the seminary that the Song of Solomon is never quoted in the New Testament. And one of the evidences that supports identifying or including an Old Testament book in the canon is the fact that it is quoted in the New Testament. And I thought, well, if the Song of Solomon is not quoted in the New Testament, maybe it doesn't belong in the Old Testament. I used to wonder about that. If I was reading the Song of Solomon and my parents came in the room, I'd move to some other part of the Bible. Didn't want people to see me reading the Song of Solomon. But I look back here, and sure enough, would you open your Bible to the Song of Solomon? Can you even find it? It's after Proverbs, and then comes Ecclesiastes, and just before Isaiah, you will find the Song of Solomon. It's a poem. It's a drama. And gentlemen, you may not like poetry, but you'll never be able to really enjoy the gospel as the Lord wants you to unless you can develop a love for something beautiful in words. This beautiful music we heard tonight comes to our ears, but poetry is music in words. And not only the rhyme, we have rhyme in English poetry. They didn't have it in Hebrew poetry. They had parallelism. But the thought is beautiful. And here in the Song of Solomon, in chapter 4, we have the bridegroom, the lover who loves this girl. He says to her in verse 7, Thou art all fair, my love. There is no spot in thee. And that is quoted in Ephesians chapter 5, where the Lord speaks of washing his church in the water till there's no spot in his church. And then further down in chapter 4 in verse 15, he describes, I guess this is she, describes him as a fountain of gardens, a well of living waters, and streams from Lebanon. And Jesus quoted that in John chapter 7 when he went to the temple and he stood up and he cried with a loud voice, If any man is thirsty, let him come to me and let him drink. And he who believes in me, out of his inmost soul will flow these streams of living water. Not only beautiful poetry, it's gospel truth. I guarantee if by the grace of God, this week at this 1888 message seminar, if somehow your heart can latch hold of the gospel and you can learn to believe the truth, I guarantee that Jesus will fulfill that promise to you, and all of your life, every day of your life, there'll be a well of living water streaming up out of your soul to refresh somebody else. But that's not the story. We've lost our train of thought here. It's chapter 5 of the Song of Solomon that captures our interest. And just think of this drama. This man who loves this woman, he must be a wonderful man of some kind. He's been on a long safari and he's come home to her. It's night, it's cold, raining, he's wet, he's hungry, he's lonely, he longs for her. And so the Septuagint, which is the Greek translation of the Old Testament, puts something in that is not in your English Bibles, because your English Bibles are translated from the Hebrew Masoretic text. But Jesus used the Greek Septuagint text sometimes, and so did the Apostle Paul. And the Septuagint adds the words "at the door." And he was knocking, knocking at the door. And the girl has gone to bed. Yes, it's raining and it's cold and it's damp inside, and she wants to get snug in bed, and she's in bed. And she's just so happy at last to be in bed. And she hears a knocking, and it bothers her. What's he knocking this time of the night for? I wish he wouldn't bother me now. I've already washed my feet. And you can't understand that, can you? I don't think anybody here can understand that unless you have been to Africa and you have lived in a grass hut with a grass roof and a cow dung floor. And the last thing you do before you go to bed at night to go to sleep, you sit in your little bed or your cot and you wash your feet. And then you never put your feet on that filthy cow dung floor again until morning, because there are lizards and rats and nobody knows what's running around the floor. And she says, I've washed my feet. How shall I defile them? Oh, I just wish I could get snug and comfy in bed here. But he keeps on knocking. And finally, something happens in the girl's heart. And she forgets about how snug and warm she is in bed, and she thinks of him out there in the cold, alone, hungry, wet. And her heart is moved for him. And she gets up, goes to open the door, but he's gone. I thought I was the only person in the world who saw 1888 right here. This is what happened. The Lord Jesus Christ, our lover. You know, the Church of England, people were annoyed that Charles Wesley wrote that hymn, Jesus, lover of my soul. That's what he is. He's a lover of the church. There isn't a woman on the face of the earth who is qualified to be the bride of the Son of God. But he's become one of us. His name is Emmanuel, God with us. And he's a man. Twice at least the New Testament calls him undare, which means a male of the species. And every healthy man in the world wants to get married. He wants a wife. And so does Jesus. There he is in the courts of heaven today, a lone man among the angels. He's bound to us by ties that can never be broken. And his bride-to-be is the church. I think the 144,000 will be they. Seems that way to me, but I don't want to argue about it. If you don't believe it, well, that's fine. But the time must come when God's people as a corporate body grow up out of this childishness that we're in. At every wedding, there are two females that are very important. One is the flower girl. And she is the most delightful little child you can imagine. Got a beautiful little new dress on, and she's got perfume on. She has a little basket of rose petals and sweet smile. Darling little child. But tell me, what bridegroom in his right mind will marry the flower girl? But there's a second female at the wedding who is also very important. And she's grown up unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of her bridegroom. He wants someone to stand by his side whom he can trust, who can understand him, who can partake with him of his life. And Jesus is waiting until this church. And I believe that the angel of the church of the Laodiceans is the leadership of the Seventh-day Adventist church. Call me a fanatic if you like. I believe the remnant church is the Seventh-day Adventist church. I believe God raised up this church as his witness in these last days. And the time must come, and thank God the time will come. And do I dare to say it? I believe it will come even in my lifetime. Not when they have some more wars and kill a few more million people. No, no, let's don't have that, please. I'm not thinking about all those terrible signs of his soon coming. I'm thinking of this most important one, that the corporate body of God's people, his bride-to-be, will stop worrying about their own salvation. They will get over this egocentric radius that ties them to legalism. And they will begin to feel a concern for him. He's out there alone. He's come to the one he loves. And so far, she's kept him knocking, knocking. Yes, I believe this is a drama. This is a touch of poetry that describes the real significance of what happened in 1888. The Lord Jesus came to his people as the bridegroom to be, saying, "Come now, it's time to get married. I love you, I'm tired of waiting." I remember a friend of mine, Elder Banks. He was getting married, and he was coming on the train, and his bride, Lita, was to wait for him at the station, and she was there, you know, waiting for the train to pull in, and the train pulled in, and she got a mischievous idea. She hid herself where she could see him, but he couldn't see her. And she watched as all the people got off of the train, and finally her husband-to-be got off and looked around, and Lita wasn't anywhere to be seen. And she said she saw the disappointment on his face that was so terrible, she said, "I couldn't help myself. I ran out and threw myself into his arms." Ellen White told us in 1904, I think it's December 12 in the review, speaking of the aftermath of the 1888 experience, she said, "The disappointment of Christ is beyond description." Is there any word from the Lord? But you know, Revelation 19, and I know our time is up here, Revelation 19 says that it's not the job of the Lamb, of the bridegroom to be, to make his wife ready. Is there anybody here in this congregation who has ever known of a bridegroom who has to dress the bride? Anybody? I've never heard of that. That's her job. The bridegroom cannot make the bride to be ready. She's got to do it. And I've been thinking about that for some time. My thoughts are not important, I tell everybody. I belong in the kindergarten. But I've been pondering and wondering just exactly what's going on. Yes, Christ is in the most holy apartment, cleansing his sanctuary, yes, yes. All that's going on, yes. But something has got to happen here on earth. And I don't know. How can we pray the bridegroom? Oh, dear bridegroom-to-be, will you please make your bride to be ready? Not his job. That's our job. We should have some initiative to honor him in these last days. I would like to close tonight a little differently than we have on any other of our evenings. Arlene Hill is, do I dare tell him? The lady's a lawyer. And I have several friends who are lawyers who love the 1888 message. I don't know why.
It's logical.
Okay.
Kind Father, we come to you humbly, confessing that we are not willing on our own to even get our feet dirty, let alone go to a cross and die for another, not knowing that our salvation is secure. Father, we need discernment. We need that eye salve. Show us, each one of us, our worst case, so that we no longer are concerned about what is going on worldly inside of us, but that we can confess it and give it over to you, because we can't even prepare for the wedding without your help. But we know, Father, that your Son washes feet, and we're willing to get those feet dirty and do whatever it takes to get not only ourselves individually prepared for that wedding, but show us, each person here tonight, as we go back to our churches after this mountaintop experience, show us how you want to use each individual to corporately help the bride get prepared. Father, that is our wish, and we know that we can ask these things in the name of your dear Son. Amen.